Good morning, Trinity Christian Fellowship.
Good morning.
I want to invite you to come on inside if you're still out in the lobby. Join us in here in the sanctuary. Hello to anyone that might be listening over the airwaves on FM 103.1. And if you're joining us a little bit later when we post this up on YouTube, hello to you too. And today, we get to celebrate moms. I'm sure, Pastor Al, you've got something in the works there.
A little bit
to help us get started. But yeah, we're grateful for the moms in our lives. I know. Hi, Mom. I'll do the news interviewee shout out on TV. Hi, Mom. But no, we're blessed to have the moms that we have in our lives. And even more so, we're blessed to have our Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So with that, I invite you to stand. I'll give us an opening prayer, and then we'll get into a time of worship this morning. Dear Lord, thank you, God, for our moms, for the ladies that brought us into this world, that you entrusted us to them. And God, we know our moms are people, just like us. None of us are perfect. But Lord, thank you so much for the blessing that they can be in our lives. And Lord, thank you especially for all the sacrifices that a mom makes for their children. It's something that, you know, we as kids, at least for me, it's retroactively, the more experience I get in life, the more I look back and I'm like, wow, really, really did a good job. So I'm grateful to our moms. And Lord, thank you for the sacrifices that you made for us, dying on the cross to forgive our sins, suffering the anguish and scorn and mockery of the very people that you came to save. And then rising again on the third day, conquering death, giving us hope of an eternity with you, Lord. Speaking promises throughout history of what that's going to be like. God, we eagerly await the fruition of those promises in that day. But in the meantime, God, we want to lift your name up in praise. I want to give you all the glory this morning. Lord, please bless this time. Please bless Pastor Al as he brings your word. And help us to be your people, united in you, both today, tomorrow, and forevermore. In your name we pray, Lord Jesus. Amen. Praise is rising.
Praise is rising. Eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring. Hearts are yearning for you. We long for you, 'cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Welcome you here. make us new. Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away.
I will lift my eyes
to the maker of the mountains I can't climb. I will lift my eyes to the calmer of the ocean's raging wild. I will lift my eyes to the healer of the hurt I hold inside. I will lift my eyes to you. I will lift my eyes to you. God, my God, I cry out. Your beloved needs you now.
Amen. You may be seated. Now I'll have Brother Mike give us a communion devotion this morning.
I found this devotion that I kind of like now I kind of don't like it, but it says, coming to the communion table is not a time to stop and reflect on how great you are. I don't know anybody, any believer that thinks it's that. And in the same token, it's not about how bad we are. It's about Christ. It says, we are not to spend this time considering the great work we have done. Yeah, right. To clean ourselves up, but to recognize that despite our efforts, apart from Christ, we can do nothing. When we assume that whatever God requires of us, that we have the power in ourselves to do it, is to make the cross and grace of Jesus of no effect. This particular person wrote, the purpose of our holy and righteous God was to save his church, but their sin could not go unpunished. Our sin could not go unpunished. It was therefore necessary for that punishment, for that sin, be transferred from those who deserved it, but could not bear it, to one who did not deserve it, but was able to bear it. The wages of sin is death, the Bible says, and someone has to pay. There is a penalty which accompanies our transgression. Man has trespassed, and therefore is the only one who should pay. And yet he cannot, being himself sinful. God has demanded payment and yet is the only one who could pay. However, he certainly should not, being himself holy, set apart what was to be done. God alone could pay, and so pay he did with the blood of his Son. The Son of God became sin and bore the wrath of his Father, being a curse on our behalf. He became our substitution, dying for our sins in our place. He did not deserve to die, we did. But he willingly became obedient to the payment required that we might be reconciled to him. We deserve to die and owe the payment. But he purchased our freedom. God has been declared both just and the justifier of the justified, which is us. We could not clean ourselves up to the point that our debt had become paid. We cannot do enough good to no longer need Jesus and the cross. So when we came to the communion table, our minds go to the fact that we are sinners. But our minds don't have to stay there. Amen. Because with Jesus, it doesn't end there. We are sinners in need of a Savior, and we have that Savior in Jesus Christ. So our minds can then go to the fact that we have a wonderful, merciful Savior, that God is so patient and gracious with us over and over and over again, that though we still struggle with sin, that our victory is in Jesus. The gospel is that Jesus died for our sins and he rose, and through faith in him, we can be reconciled to the Father. Father God, you did it all for us. You saw your Son in the flesh. You saw your Son in the flesh die for us, be ridiculed for us, be put to shame. Lord, even the people days ago that were waving palm branch and saying Hosanna, many of them are now saying crucify him. God, but out of your grace, out of your mercy, out of who you are, Lord, we became reconciled to you, Lord, and we praise you for that. In your Son's name, Jesus. Amen.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, the death of Christ I live. trust in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand. Here in the power of Christ I stand.
Good morning, Trinity Christian Fellowship. Happy Mother's Day. Really appreciating all you mothers out there. Let's go to God in prayer. Great God in heaven, thank you for the mothers that surround us in our community. Lord, thank you for the hidden things they did while we were carried within them. That you were there protecting, guiding, nurturing, keeping healthy, Lord. Through the years that are exhausting of rearing children, Lord, thank you for the energy that you supplied to the mothers. And Lord, in the years after that, in all the hidden things that the mothers do, in their prayers and their working behind the scenes and their encouragement and so on, Lord, thank you for our mothers and what you've done through them, Lord. Lord, help them to continue to be warriors of prayer on our behalf, Lord, and help us to be warriors of prayer as well, praying as Jesus taught us how to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Turning your Bibles to the book of Acts chapter 24, call this passage point by point. Paul is in his defense before the governor Felix, and he is going through the charges and answering them point by point. Mothers oftentimes are asked to be judge or referee in a lot of cases throughout their lifetime. Oftentimes one child says, "He hurt me." The other one says, "I did not, did so, did not." And mothers know sometimes you have to dig into the details. Sometimes you have to find out exactly what happened, who said what, and so on. Other times, you don't have to hear a thing. You just say, "Be quiet. So-and-so apologized. Now go do your chores, do your homework, leave me alone." You don't need the details. Why? You've heard it all before. It was 20 times yesterday, it'll be 20 times tomorrow, and it's only up to 10 today. Sometimes it's just the same old, same old. Sometimes you need the details. Well, in this case, Paul shares the details. Point by point, he answers the charges that were put against him, and he focuses on being human. When you're in a trial, it can be dehumanizing. A lot of things in life, unfortunately, can be dehumanizing. Paul shows, "I'm a human being." Looking at verse 5 and 6, which are the two verses we're going to read aloud together, a lawyer named Tertullus, who is representing the chief priests who have come from Jerusalem to Caesarea to lay their charges against Paul before Governor Felix, they say the three things he's charged with. Let me read verse 5 and 6. "For we have found this man a plague, a creator of dissension among all the Jews throughout the world, and a ringleader of the sect of the Nazarenes. He even tried to profane the temple, and we seized him and wanted to judge him according to our law." First off, Paul answers these one at a time. He says, "I am not a disease." His defense is in verses 11 through 13 to this charge of him being a plague. Now, the Greek word for in verse 5 is the word plague. They thought he was a disease. They dehumanized him in this respect. He says, no, I'm not a plague. And he says three reasons. Number one, he hasn't been there long enough to be a plague. It takes a little while for a plague to hatch. He hadn't been there that long. Number two, he just came to worship. That's all he came to do. I remember a long time ago in another church, we had some people who were kind of getting critical consistently on Sunday mornings. And I just remember one song that our choir had sung earlier that one of those Sundays. I don't know what you came to do, but I just came to praise the Lord. In reality, you have to ask yourself a question. Why do I go to church? Why am I part of a church? Is it there to be a problem, or am I there to praise God? The third reason he says he's not a plague is that he says that there weren't any people exposed to his plague. There's no one who got sick because of him, so to speak. Nobody infected. There was no crowd around him. If you remember, when Paul first gets back here to Jerusalem, the elder of the church, James, tells him all the local believers are scared of him. And so they weren't really cozying up to him. He really hadn't had time to gather any new converts. All he had was a few people that were part of his own posse, and they weren't around at the time either. So there was nobody who was contagious with his plague. Was Christ ever accused of being a plague? Well, actually, John the Baptist wanted him to be a little bit more infectious than he was. If you remember when John the Baptist was arrested, he noticed the difference between Jesus and himself, that John had gathered the crowds and he wasn't the least bit worried about telling people where to go. Jesus was always leaving the crowds and going to take care of the individual. And that was a bit concerning to him. So he sent messengers asking, are we supposed to expect a different Messiah than you? And Jesus told those messengers in Luke chapter 7, verse 22, he says, go and tell John the things that you have seen and heard, that the blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. Jesus is telling John, I did not come to go viral or to be a plague. I came not to kick people's rear ends. I came to lay hands on them, to wash their feet, to hug them, to give them love. The second charge that Paul answers, he says that I am not a deviant. Verses 14 to 16 is his defense in that regard. Remember back in verse 5, it says he was a leader of a sect or a dissension or a division. The Greek word there is heresis, which is where we get our word heresy from. It basically describes a person who was part of a group and wanted to split off, break away, become a section or a sect away from the group, in distinction from them, insert some gap between the two. And then Tertullus calls them the group of the Nazarenes. Now, there's a denomination now called Nazarenes. Back then, the phrase Nazarene or the term Nazarene was a term, a derogatory term. It's sort of like calling a person a hick or from Podunkville, or something derogatory like that. Nazareth did not have the reputation of the cream of the crop or the best or the brightest coming from it. And so it was a slur, definitely a dehumanizing slur again. Well, what's Paul's response in this regard? Three things. First off, he says, I can't be a deviant because we worship the same God. Didn't have a different God, different name, different stories about him. No, it's all the same. Number two, same book. Same Old Testament. The New Testament had not been written or codified yet. And so we have the same book in our worship as the synagogue has in theirs, with no distinction in that. But then he adds a third thing, interesting enough, which turns the tables a little bit, resurrection. You see, in the Jewish religion, there were two major groups at that time, Pharisee, Sadducee. The Pharisees believed in resurrection. The Sadducees did not believe in resurrection. The thing is that the Pharisee was a bigger group. The Sadducee was a smaller group. And in this, Paul is basically saying, we agree with the bigger group, which is to say that maybe in this case, the Sadducee, who the leaders of the temple were, the chief priests, the ones who were sitting in court, they were part of the group that said no resurrection, i.e., they're the deviant ones, is kind of what he's inferring there. That's the implication. Well, was Jesus ever accused of being deviant? Jesus responds to that in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, starting with verse 17. He says, "Do not think that I have come to destroy the law or the prophets. I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill." Skipping to verse 20. "For I say to you that unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven." He's underscoring, we are not about doing less or other than the Old Testament law. We are just getting started with the Old Testament, and we are exceeding way beyond excessive faith in God. Well, the third charge that he addresses is called, "I don't desecrate." And that defense is in verses 17 to 18. Tertullus, in verse 6, mentions he tried to profane or desecrate the temple. Notice he doesn't say how this desecration was supposedly done. If you look back at the story, Paul is accused of bringing a Greek into the temple. They'd seen him earlier in the week with a Greek with him, so they just presumed that if Paul was in the temple, that he had the Greek there somewhere, and that was desecrating the temple. The reason Tertullus doesn't go into this is because the judge, Governor Felix, is a Greek dude. It would not gain them any brownie points with the judge to say, hey, he desecrated our temple by bringing somebody just like you into the temple. So he leaves out that little bit. What's Paul's response to desecrating the temple? First off, he says, "I brought alms. I brought money to help the poor, the hungry in Jerusalem. Part of a religious thing. I'm not there to desecrate." Number two, he calls the Israelites my people, my nation, my folks, my family. And that personal pronoun, my, is important. There is a word I hope you get a little bit scared of, a little bit paranoid about how you use it, and maybe how other people around you use it too. It's a word that slips into our conversations, maybe Freudian slip-like, showing that we have contempt, that we have a point of putting down, causing separation with somebody we don't like. And what's that word? It's the word those. T-H-O-S-E, those. For instance, "Oh, you're one of those people. Oh, I saw those people down at the intersection again." Those. It's a word that sees somebody we don't care for at all. And we grab that word and we insert it as space, as gap between us and those people. Arm's length, distance. See, Paul doesn't use that word here. When he's talking about the Jewish people, he says, my people, draws close, even though all they've been trying to do was cause problems or kill him or whatever. My people. But the last thing that he throws in here is he says, "I was found purified in the temple." And what does that mean? Paul was asked by James to do some activities in the temple to show that he had respect for traditions and so on. In order for him to do that, he had to go through a time of purification, about 7 days. See, if you were a local always going to the temple, you'd be waved through no problem, because the whole area was a little bit more concerned about, you know, kosherness and so on. But if you came like Paul did from out of the area, across the Roman Empire, obviously, they would say that he had probably been in some areas that were not ceremonially pure. So he had to go through a detox time of about 7 days, a purification time, in order to get through. And so, you know, before he got into the temple, he'd have to show the bouncer at the door his pass that said, hey, I've done the 7 days of quarantining. Sort of like if you wanted to go to a restaurant during the pandemic, have to show your vaccination card or your latest negative COVID test. In order to get in, you'd have to be approved. Well, Paul was arrested in the temple. That means he got past the bouncer. He was there showing he was purified. He had respect for the rules and the regulations. That's what he was showing. And showing, I don't desecrate. Well, was Jesus ever accused of desecrating the temple? No, actually, if you remember, he cleansed it twice from the people who were in charge of it. The last time, Mark chapter 11, verse 17, is it not written, my house shall be called a house of prayer for all nations, but you have made it a den of robbers. Well, that finishes his point-by-point response to all the things that he was charged by. And sometimes, if it's like in our legal system, the legalities and so on, you have to go point-by-point, cover your bases and so on. Sometimes, if it's just for your own conscience, you know, Paul is saying in verse 16 that he sought to have his conscience clear before God and before man. So, if somebody has accusations or things they don't like about us, sometimes we need to ask the question, could this be true? And go bit by bit through our lives to try to find out, is there substance to this? That can be important for self-evaluation. But in this story, Paul, as in a legal proceeding, goes point by point, thorough, wonderfully, logically, awesome, and doesn't convince anybody. The prosecutor still wants him to be guilty. The people bringing the charges, they want him dead. The judge just throws him back into jail, unmoved. For all the point by point he does, it doesn't do anything. In many respects, most of us hopefully do not have any legal problems, at least right now. But maybe we do have people that don't like us. You know, and we might go up to them and say, hey, why don't you like me? And they say, well, because of X, Y, and Z. And so you can explain your thing on X and Y and Z. And then you say, well, now do you like me? And they'll say, no. They're just making up X, Y, and Z because they don't like you, but they want it to sound a little bit more reasonable or fair-minded than that. Oftentimes, people just don't like us for whatever spiritual quirk that they're wrestling through. And in looking at the Sermon on the Mount, looking at the ethics of Jesus, maybe we want to do something other than point by point, but address the spirit of the situation. And oftentimes, you can do that simply by doing this. Tell the person, I know you hate me, go right ahead and hate all you want. I hope it makes you feel better, but I want you to know something. I will continue to love you. You can gossip about me, you can slander me. I will not slander you. I will not speak negatively about you. And leave it at that. What this does is basically being your own defense. Promoting your own self-defense. It's fun. It gives you endorphins. You know, we can't pat ourselves on the back enough. I mean, if we're alone in a room all by ourselves, we will win a debate with ourselves all the time. We are winners in those scenarios, making ourselves look good. And what point does it do? Every time a politician has some accusation, every star, sports, or whatever, they're always defending themselves and worthless words. Of course, we defend ourselves. What's better is when somebody else defends us. And so when you leave it to somebody else, here's what happened. Two come forward. First off, friends. People who can look and see how you're acting and how your accuser's acting and are willing to weigh in and say to the other person, you're being a jerk. Knock it off. They can say things that your words are never going to make it through. And what's important is when they're the ones that are being fried, for you as their friend to spot, to see what's going on, and you be the defender for them. Isn't it wonderful, instead of patting ourselves on the back, is that we have one another's back. I defend you, you defend me. Neither one of us gets self-defensive. And we're protected. But the second to show on up is God. God can make an impact where you and I can't. Where our words fail, He can make an impression. He is a great reconciler. And if anybody can do it, it's going to be Him. It's amazing. we got to understand in this whole accusation defense type thing that we're human beings. And also, the person accusing, they're a human being too. They're not an it. They're not a thing. They're not a those. They're a human being. And we leave them to the greatest reconciler in the universe, our God. Let's pray. God in heaven, help us to leave room for your activity. Lord, help us in all deference to promote people looking at you, not looking at ourselves. And Lord, I pray that we would have one another's back and appreciating those that are around us. In the name of Jesus, I pray, amen. Now let's say our benediction together. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Happy Mother's Day.